Very happy to be worshiping. I want to thank your pastor for allowing us the opportunity for sharing in this family life day. And let us remember to keep Pastor Aki in our prayers, because he's, still very ill, I think. We'll need our prayers. But I'm happy to share the experience on his behalf. And I hope that in addition to what you have heard today already through the Sabbath school, that you'll be blessed by the end of this service. You know, I live quite near to here. Yes, we moved here a few months ago. Because we have obligations at our other church, having to go. And this week I said, I'm not going to church this week, I'm so very tired. I'm not going to go this week, I'll watch online. And then about Thursday, Pastor Aki called and said, well, I want you to go to a church. So I said, that's quite okay. So I'm very happy to share the experience. And I hope a little that I will share the time that we have to be a blessing to you and be a blessing to me. You know, the theme that you have that Pastor Aki, I can feel that Pastor Aki had given besides your family. So I think, let's keep up much, not much changes to the program as much as possible. But I think for the fight to happen, I will share with you just one thing that we could do if we're to fight our families. Whether it's a church family or individual families, I will share just one way that I think we could do this. And I have a few slides, and I'll leave some handouts that I think you could continue to use. So that I may not have to go into much detail because, you know, time is gone already. But what I want to say to you is that sometimes the one thing I want to take away is that probably we need to change the emphasis on how we see family. Sometimes we always say the family is under attack, the family is under threat, we are so much struggling. You know, when you check family life, it's always so rough, so many issues in family life. But today I want us to change how we see it and say, let's celebrate family life. Amen. Let's celebrate what we have. You know, has not there been some good things in your family? No matter how bad it is, you can find something good in your family. Amen. You know, maybe you have sons who are healthy, you have nephews. I have some nice nephews. I celebrate the fact that my mother only has grandsons. She has no daughters, so she's looking to me now. Let's celebrate what's good in our families. Every family has something. Of course, we know there are issues. There will always be issues. But maybe it's because we've spent so much time decrying issues in family life while the devil has his way with us sometimes. But if you should turn the switch on him to say, I'm going to celebrate God's goodness in my family life, because I think it will make a difference. So in this fight, I want to arm yourselves with a vision for celebrating what's positive in your family life. Let the devil see that God still is able to bless and to keep you, whatever happens in your family. So yes, family are on top. But I believe by celebrating what's good in our families, we will find the strength to unlock some of those difficult issues we have in life. I believe if you celebrate sometimes what's good in your family, it gives you courage to try harder. You know, some of those marriages that are struggling and you're finding the problems between your husband and wife. But if you should change the switch a bit and celebrate, then you find the strength to fight on. I was happy to hear about 22 years of marriage this morning. Very well done. Congratulations to you. And thank you for saying to us that sometimes it has not always been easy, but you found a way to change even the difficult circumstances and make them positive. I think you have a wonderful marriage and I pray that God will keep you. So by celebrating family life, you will find the strength to carry on. Sometimes when you're about to give up, if you could find those bright sparks in your family, rather than throw in the towel, rather than wipe right off that son or daughter who has gone astray, you will find the courage to love them again. So in my family life, my youngest sister got pregnant, and in a Christian family, that's a big no-no. You write them off, you close the door, you bring them out of church. But my mother and my father and all of us sort of embraced her about 7 years ago, and this August, my nephew celebrated 7 years old. And it's been such a blessing to be in the family. You see, sometimes if we celebrate what's positive and what's good, irrespective of all the devil may want to use it for bad, God can make a positive influence. I look back over my sister whose birthday is today as well. So her son was in 28 and her 15. And I said, her birthday this morning. When I look back and say, he is such a blessing to her in her life. He keeps her company. You know, it started off bad, but God can take even the bad things that the devil intends. And if you celebrate what's good, he can make you wonderful.
Amen.
So I encourage you today to arm yourself with a spirit of celebration. But in addition to that, one of the things that I want to talk about in celebrating our families today is how do we practically deal with those issues when they come. I want to share some practical things. And so by the end, I hope I will give you probably a little thought that may help you in your own family experience as we celebrate family. I want to help you move the slides now quickly. One of the big things that I want to focus on, yes, is how do we therefore celebrate our differences? Differences are often what we devil use these to cause great problems in our families, in our churches. Because you're different from me and we don't see eye to eye, the devil then uses that to cause lots of problems in our family experience. You read it this morning with the aunt and the siblings. We're different. What I want to say to you, there's so many things I can talk about. I want to talk about how do we celebrate what is different in your family life? Again, turning this a bit further on this issue. You see, go to the next slide. I know you have a lot of children here. I don't want to do children. Are you looking? Next slide. I was looking at the world this week with tools.
Oh, no, not this.
Burning my finger. But when I look at the tools that I was using, children, you look up. What do you see there? You see on the one hand, what do you see? Tell me some of the things you see, children. You see a hammer. Yes, and you see a saw. And you see a what? A screwdriver. Yes, you notice that if you had a set of tools where all of them were the very same, if all of them were a hammer, who would do the screwing out of screws? If all of the tools in the toolbox were screwdrivers, who would do the knocking of nails? So in your family, children, as in our church family and our families, each person is different and each person has a different function or role. Very important. But we're talking about how we therefore use these differences, these apparent differences, and celebrate them. Next slide. Talk about them for the children. Go home and look at the other little thing I'm going to show, but time for them. But the tools talk to each other. You know the tools talk to each other, children? Yes, man, the tools talk. And then, you know, I'm not as, you know, if you look at the saw says, look at me, I'm slim and I'm very vibrant. I can cut through wood. The hammer says, I don't have, you know, your slenderness, but I have bulk, I have substance, I'm heavy. And the screwdriver may be very thin. But every one of them know different in how they're made up. You know, we use them based on their differences. And that is what I want to talk about today. Next slide. Say the same way God uses us. And I want to share with you that we are different and very unique. If you turn your Bible to Psalm 139, and a whole passage is important, but I won't go through that. You can use that text and keep using it as your meditation this week. Psalm 139. The Lord tells us in very detailed and graphic way just how special we are here. You can go back one slide, bro. So let's look at verse 13 to verse 15. The Bible says, Psalm 139. Go back two slides. The Bible says, I'm using the New Living Translation. The Bible says, you made all the delicate and inner parts of my body. This is the thing we're talking about how you made. He said, God knit me together in my mother's womb. What did he do? He knit me together. He put me carefully together in my mother's womb. Nobody looks the way I look. Nobody has 9 ears. My wife teased me about my ears when I was growing up, but nobody has 9 ears. You know, everybody is different. God said, the Bible says, he knit you together in your mother's womb. You know how knitting happens? Very nice. And then the Bible says, thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Oh man, thank you Lord for making me who I am. He didn't make me like you so I could be by myself. In school, growing up, they used to teach us a poem they called "I'm Glad I'm Me" by the Roof Donna Pendleton. It's like, no one looks the way I do. No one says the things I say. I am special. I am me. There is no one I'd rather be but me. I am special. That's what God says here. God made us special. He said, look at this. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I knew it. You watched me as I was formed in utter seclusion. I was woven together in the darkness. So each person must understand that you are unique in the eyes of God and special, and for a good reason, you are different by design. God made it so. As a matter of fact, Luke 12 and verse 6 to 7 tells us a little bit more. The Bible says, Luke 12 and verse 6 and 7. What does the Bible say there? The Bible says, what is the price of 5 sparrows? 2 copper coins. Yet God does not forget a single one of them. And the very hair on your head are numbered. So don't be afraid. You are more valuable to God than a whole flock of sparrows. Different by design, my brothers and sisters, children, young people, adults, you are different by design. Let us celebrate that difference. You see, God knows you more than you know yourself. That's the issue. God knows you better than you know yourself. Therefore, you can be honest when you go to Him. You see, many times when we pray the prayers that God don't know that you are not some other nice person. God knows that you have weaknesses. He knows, so you can go honest to Him and say, Lord, you know I love cake. Help me with it. You see, if you understand that God already knows everything about you, then you don't have to panic up. You say, Lord, I am this, I am that. Lord, you know I love to talk too much. Help me with it. By understanding that God knows you, you're different by design, then you can open up and be honest with God. But here's the issue. The issue is that sometimes we don't know ourselves. So how can you be honest with God? If you don't know yourself, then how can you talk to God honestly? So the challenge for every Christian, or every person, every child of God is, how can I be true to myself? The Bible tells us, you know, in John 16 verse 3, that when the Spirit of truth comes, He will do what? Guide us into all truth. How much truth? Does that include truth about myself? All truth. He says when the Spirit of truth comes, the Holy Spirit will guide us into all truth, including about myself. So this morning, this afternoon, I want to say to you, get to know yourself. It's the biggest challenge in life, to get to know yourself. Some people say that you don't really get to know yourself until you're 28 years old. For the first 7 years of life, you're getting to know your environment. But the second step, when you're getting into teenage years, you start getting to know other people who are around you. When you reach into 21, you're starting to look at the opposite sex, but you still haven't known yourself. So some people say, I don't know, by 28, you should, that's there, you should get married. There's no prescription for you to get married. What they're saying is know yourself. Yeah. You know, when I was getting married, the counselor said to me, 2 of you seem to be walking up that aisle, but just 6 of you getting married.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who you think you are, who people think you are, and who you really are. Thanks to. Yes. So you go up there and you have this perception of who you are and who people think you are, and you go into the marriage with it. This is the problem. You go into the family situation with that. So get to know yourself. But the Bible promises that when the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all of you, including the truth about yourself. So don't live in the power of the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit reveal who you are to you. For God already knows you. Then you can be honest with God. Then you can be honest with each other. This is the issue we have in family life. We can't be honest about who we are with Him, with each other. Then the Bible says, that we can bear God's life. There are different ways in which many of us are different. I mean, there are different ways that they can categorize the difference. The first one is, I am male and you are female. So we are different by our gender, no? And, you know, men see the world differently and women see the world differently. I want to show you that clip now. Could you cue the clip now? That just shows you how different we are just by the way we see the world. I want to show you this clip, but I want to pay close attention to what is in the clip to see how different men and women are and how they see the world. Is the clip there? Yeah, let's see if you can see it. I hope it will come up. That's one way we're different. Actually, we're different by our gender. Let's see if you can watch this one. I hope it will work out.
And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head. And it's relentless. And I don't know if it's going to stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever going to stop.
have a nail in your head.
It's not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen.
See, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail.
See, you're not listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just... Sometimes it's like... There's this achy... I don't know what it is. Now my sweaters are snapped. I mean, all of them.
She doesn't want you to fix the problem at work. She wants you to listen and empathize. I mean, it's a whole lot. I want not to talk about gender today. It's a whole lot of talking by itself. Yeah. The second type of difference, I'll give you some flavor for it, is when difference in terms of our personality. That's a big one. I spend most of my time on personalities today. Because I think this one probably has a big door to give you. So we're different in terms of our personalities. Now, and throughout the ages, there have been lots of talk about different personalities. But let me share with you your temperament, your personality, who you are, is your manner of thinking, is your manner of believing, your manner of reacting to things. It's your disposition, it's who you are, it's your nature, they call it. It's your personality. This is not something that is learned, this is innate to you. So this is your way of behaving, reacting, thinking. It's who you are, it's your nature, it's your disposition. That's what I'm talking about when I talk about your temperament. And, you know, gospel writers says a lot about this. Next slide, please. Listen to what Ellen White says. Listen to Ellen White says, life will be happier and more productive if we would understand something about our own temperaments, our personalities, and the those with whom we associate in our families. Not all can be helped in the same way. Watch this out now. Look at this one and then underline. It says,